This camera right here, the Sony a6500, this camera is so capable and has popped it off for so many creators out there, including myself. Now, I haven't given it a lot of love around the channel. And the thing is that many of you have reached out about the 6500, how to use it. Is it still a good camera? Is it still a worthy investment? Especially being that now we're in 2020 and this thing was released years ago. And with Sony and Panasonic and Canon making all these new announcements, and where does that leave the 6500? Well, if you're looking at some of those full frame options that are out there, then you're likely looking at your pocketbook and wallet and thinking like, yeah, I don't think I can make that kind of investment right now. And many of you also still have access in other countries to the 6500, and it's still reasonably priced for some of you. So we always say, or you hear things of like, leave the past in the past, leave that in the rear view. But I think right now, in the state of the world that we're in, I'm sure plenty of us are like, no, the past was great. Because right now, I mean, can you even remember when we were able to travel? Why don't we actually take a field trip? All right, you beautiful humans, welcome back from that field trip. And I'll tell you what, when we stepped off of the plane coming back here to Colorado, and yes, Colorado, it's a great place to live, it's a great place to come home to, but it's not Belize. So the thing is, I want to talk about the camera because that's what we're here for, and really sharing with you the a6500 and the Sigma 16mm and what I was able to do with this setup. Now, the 6400 had been launched, released, and I just didn't take it with me. I had the 6500 and I did take my GoPro, and I'll have some footage in the next couple of weeks and months on the channel because I have some projects I'm working on that will fit into. I have half a terabyte of footage from that trip that I haven't really done much with at all. So the thing is, going back to the camera, I want to talk to you about what it was capable of, how I used it, even the camera settings, the picture profile, giving you a little bit of rationale and just kind of telling you that, I mean, you look at the footage, you tell me whether it's still capable, especially even in today, 2020, with all of these new cameras coming out. The picture profile that I did use is Cine 4. And of course, no shocker there, a lot of people talk about Cine 4. The reason why I use Cine 4 is because I'm very familiar with it and I can grade it quite well, not to mention the fact that where I was filming, the backdrop, the way that it protects and rolls off, talking about the shadows and the highlights. And I think Cine 2 is a great picture profile. But I also think that Cine 4, for me, is where I needed to be because I felt comfortable grading that footage. The dynamic range that I can get out of it, and just the fact that I can bring it into post and do very little, actually. Like, I did very little. Worked with the exposure. And so linking up below in the description, my settings for Cine 4, but before you head down there, let me just tell you folks, I'm gonna sound like other creators out there and let you know that this is just a jumping off point. I chose these settings based on the way that I was filming, the look that I was going for, and where I was. So you can certainly copy verbatim picture profile settings, camera settings, and that's fine. And I've done that. It's a jumping off point though. I'm gonna tell you, you need to go out there and create and look at the footage and see what you're getting. I mean, I took my laptop with me and I dumped the footage at the end of every day, even if I was completely exhausted, and looked at the footage to make sure that I was where I needed to be, at least visually. And for me, I felt like it met the need. So just take into consideration that those settings were my settings and I don't own those settings. I didn't like it. I experimented with those settings to find the look that I was going for. I've had filmmakers tell me, like, if you're filming outside, Cine 2 is the way to go. And then I've had other filmmakers say, no, if you're filming outside, Cine 4 is the way to go. Again, I feel comfortable in sending four. Like I said, plenty of you might come at me and say, like, you're shooting in the wrong picture profile, the wrong settings. But those were the result. That's what I got. So those are the results that I got. And I'm happy with that look. So everything creatively is subject to, you know, people's point of view and what they see and what they like. And listen, I'm just out here trying to create the things that I enjoy and sharing that with you. Now, as I always talk about filming in 4K and filming in 24, that's my favorite. I just like the look of it. So when we talk about the detail in those camera settings, I had put my camera at -5 because I can bring those things back in post. Now, I also filmed a lot in 60 and 120 frames. Now, the beauty about the 6500 is it's got IBIS. So the beauty about that is that it helps eliminate a lot of those micro jitters because the Sigma is not a stabilized lens, as we've talked about on this channel. So I give IBIS a lot of guff. Well, the Sony IBIS, a lot of guff. But when it comes to the micro jitters and some of the things that I was doing, it did actually come in handy. But filming in 60 and 120 frames per second, now the detail, instead of a negative, I ended up bringing it up to around 0. And, you know, because again, things are gonna look a little bit softer. And so if I wanna bring some of that detail back, then that's kind of where I needed it to be. We're talking about 8-bit color here too, folks. So you also have to be realistic when it comes to the colors. Now I'm in Belize and there's a lot of colors, but a lot of highlights. And here's the thing. When you are also filming, you need to consider the setting and your white balance. And that made the difference. And the thing is, I'm in Belize, my white balance, it's sun. Everywhere, it's sun. Am I filming inside? Not really. I didn't do a lot of filming inside. I mostly filmed out in the sun. So I knew what my white balance needed to be. Now my exposure, that's another thing, because things can get blown out like crazy. And I was like at F11 with a variable ND filter on my camera. And of course, adjusting that, especially when I'm out on the water or just when it's like high noon all the time. Not high noon, but you're getting sun a lot. And of course, moving over to the higher frame rate, so the 60 and 120, so the shots that were on the boat and I'm holding this camera, and I'm sure the guys that are driving the boat are like, what is this guy doing? I had my camera strap wrapped around me, locked in, and I was trying really hard to get those shots as we were going across with the chop. And here's the thing, like the chop wasn't bad. I mean, in Belize, in certain spots, like the water is deep, and then other spots like where we were, it was pretty shallow. So there wasn't a lot of chop. And so the weather was fantastic. The water was great. So for me to hold the camera out there and having everything wrapped up, I mean, you're not gonna get gimbal style. And so I shot at a higher frame rate. So the image is gonna be a little softer. And also I had to stabilize a little bit in post, but not too much because again, with the IBIS, it did help take the edge off of those micro jitters that can occur. But I'll tell you what, my whole body was just like, people were looking at me like, this guy's got to stick up his you know what, and he looks ridiculous. Not all the time, but if I was trying to stabilize a shot on the water, that's what I look like. So it wasn't fun, but I got some pretty cool shots. All right, so for those of you that are 6500 users, hopefully this helped you. And for those of you that might be interested in the 6500, and it does, it has the IBIS in it, and I know I trash it sometimes, but with the Sigma, the fact that it is such a sharp lens, such a capable lens, you will at least eliminate a lot of those micro jitters that can occur with handheld footage. So it's still a consideration, especially for those of you that still have access to the 6500 in the countries that you are in. And all these other cameras coming out, that's just gonna continue to drive the price down. In 2020, it's still a very capable camera. So what can I help you with? What questions do you have for me? Realizing that those are custom settings that I've used, the way that I film, my style, and the look that I'm going for. So just keep that in mind. But you know I'm always around YouTube. It is the best place to reach me. So hit me up in the comment section below. You go do those things that matter. Keep rocking the faces. I'm gonna keep creating some value here, and I really appreciate your time and attention. Until next time, I will catch you right back here on the next one.